Hello everyone, welcome to this video on UPSC previous year question paper discussion. In this particular video, I'm going to discuss basically the previous year questions from 2018 UPSC pre-examination paper, preliminary examination paper. And before I start, I would just acknowledge that the content for this video has been taken from Gradeup. So Gradeup is an amazing portal when it comes to examination preparation, so exams like UPSC and public service commissions and state exams. Besides that, there is amazing content for PCSJ exams also, and banking, railways, CDS and what not. So you can just check out their portal. Also, the best part about Gradeup is what attracted me was that their test series are not as expensive as other portals. They're very economic, plus the content is equally good when it comes to the quality. It's equally good like other sites, and it's not as expensive. So that's another important advantage of Gradeup. And Gradeup as a portal is comparatively young, but the educators, the stuff that they have, the downloads available there, everything is so helpful. They have daily quizzes, textbook based quizzes, and subject wise based quizzes, and it's just amazing, and all of that for free. So you can check out their portal, or you can download their app or the website, which is www.gradeup.co. So you can check out their content, and I think that's enough of promotion because I've used their content. I was obligated to do it, but this is not sponsored, okay? I'm doing it voluntarily. Anyway, promotions aside, let's get started. So UPSC 2018 question paper is what we're going to discuss in this particular lesson. I already have the answers given here, so there might be cases where the answer would show and you would be able to see it. So you would find that, okay, there's no need of reading it along, why waste time, just forward it. Do not do that, okay? Because when you do that, what happens is that you would skip your hours of reading, your time of reading. If you have got ample time and if you're well versed with preparation, you can obviously skip it or maybe take screenshots of the questions or the explanation. But if you really want to prepare like a serious first time learner for the previous year questions, pay attention to whatever is being read or said or is on the screen, and just pay attention, and you can download the video, you can take screenshots of answers, or the simplest thing for you to do is go to Gradeup app or the website and download this video from there for free and learn at your own pace. Alright, so let's get started. The first question is, with reference to Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, IRNSS, consider the following statement. So as you can see, that it's already available in the answer. We won't waste much time in decoding the answer, reading the options. We'll just directly jump on to the option, the correct option, read only the correct options, that only that retains in our mind, and then read the explanation part. So only the correct information is retained and not the extra rubbish stuff, because many times when you read a lot of rubbish stuff, you tend to remember some of the rubbish stuff and you tend to mark that correct in the examination. So I'm not going to follow that practice, because according to me, you might have a different practice and you might be true in that and it might be working well for you. But according to me and for me, the practice that works well is when you read only the correct options and fuck the rest. I mean, sorry for the language, but yeah, just chuck the rest, okay? So let's get started now. So with reference to Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, I've already read this. The following statements have to be considered, whether they are true or not. That is what the question is asking. So answer A, that is one only, is the only correct statement here, which is IRNSS has 3 satellites in geostationary and 4 satellites in geosynchronous orbits. Alright, so that was about it. Now the explanation says that Indian Regional Navigation System, satellite system, is IRNSS, with an operational name of NAVIC. Cool, so its operational name is NAVIC, and navigation with Indian constellation. Now this one is an autonomous regional satellite navigation system that provides accurate real-time positioning and timing services. What is important for you to remember is it provides accurate real-time positioning and timing services, and that it is an autonomous regional satellite navigation system. Now it covers India and a region extending 1500 kilometers around it. The region is also important for you to know with the boundaries. UPSC generally plays with numbers, so just be sure with them. With plans for further extensions, now the system at present consists of a constellation of 7 satellites with 2 additional satellites on the ground as standby. So a constellation of 7 plus 2 satellites on standby. Now, out of these 7 that are not on standby and are in the constellation, we 3 satellites are located in geostationary orbit, that is GEO, or 4 in inclined geosynchronous orbit, that is GSO. Cool. So it has like 7 plus 2 satellites, and out of the 7, 3 plus 4 are divided as GEO and GSO respectively. Then we have the next question, which is consider the following phenomena. So light is affected by gravity, universe is constantly expanding, and matter warps its surrounding space-time. So which of the above are predictions of Albert Einstein's general relativity theory, often discussed in media? So correct option is answer D, which is all the 3 options, 1, 2, and 3. So that's like the right answer for you. Moving on to the explanation, we have Einstein's general theory of relativity is based on how we think gravity governs the behavior of universe. That's what the theory is about. Now, we know that matter in the universe warps the surrounding fabric of space-time. And this warping effect is what we refer to as gravity. So, what is gravity, guys? If it comes in the examination, you don't really have to answer it by yourself. You just have to pick the right option, which is matter in the universe warps the surrounding fabric of space-time. And it is this warping effect that we call gravity. Now, according to Einstein's theory, light, just like any other form of matter, is affected by gravity. So, light also falls in a gravitational field. Isn't that amazing? That's about this question. Moving on to the next question we have. With reference to genetically modified mustard, GM mustard, developed in India, consider the following statements. So, correct option is B, okay? And we have to answer which of the following are correct. So, I'll just jump onto the correct option without wasting any further time. So, GM mustard has the genes that allow the plant cross-pollination and hybridization. Option 2, if you could see it. Now, DMH11, that is its scientific name, is a genetically modified GM mustard hybrid. Now, what are hybrids? So, hybrids are normally obtained by crossing 2 genetically diverse plants from the same species. The species is same, but their genes are different. So, combining the 2 gives us a hybrid species. Hybrid organism or whatever. Now, the first generation of spraying resulting from it has higher yields than what either of the parents is individually capable of giving. Cool. Now, but there is no natural hybridization system in mustard, unlike cotton, maize, tomato. So, cotton, maize, tomato. You have got another fact from this explanation. Cotton, maize, and tomato have a natural hybridization system, and GM mustard does not have any. So, this is because its owners, the owners of GM mustard, contain both the female pistil and male stamen, that is the reproductive organs, making the plant naturally self-pollinating. I think that was clear. Moving on to the next question, we have considered the following pairs. We have terms in the news on one side and context or topic on the other side. This is from 2018, so questions are also from 2017 current affairs. So just pay attention to that, because anyway you're not going to revise current affairs from 2017. But at least you're getting a hint of questions from past year's paper in this paper. So pay attention to it. So this is like the options given to us, and we have to identify which of these is the correct pair. So I've practiced this like several times, and I know the answer is blockchain technology, which is related to digital or cryptocurrency. And I think everybody knows that, because CRISPR is not about particle physics, and Bell 2 is not about artificial intelligence. So the only correct pair is 2, that is blockchain with digital or cryptocurrency. So that's like the only correct option here. Now CRASP, or CRISPR that I call it, is a gene editing tool that can be used to modify DNA in cells. And blockchain, that was the correct option. And Bell 2 experiment is a particle physics experiment. So these two were actually cross-matched, like in a way, right? So CRISPR had no option in reality, but why are we discussing it anyway? But anyway, so Bell 2 experiment, it is a particle physics experiment designed to study the properties of B mesons. What are B mesons? Another question for you. So B mesons are heavy particles containing a bottom quark. Then we have, which of the following statements best describes carbon fertilization? So you can see the answer is right there just below the question, which is A. So we'll just read the correct option, which is increased plant growth due to increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is carbon fertilization. Now, larger amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere that has resulted from rising anthropogenic emissions should help the growth of plants, which use carbon dioxide during photosynthesis. Now, the effect ought to increase crop yields. That's why carbon fertilization is increased plant growth due to increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The next question is, when the alarm of your smartphone rings in the morning, you wake up and tap it to stop the alarm, which causes your geyser to be switched on automatically. Now, the smart miner, it is actually a mirror, not a miner, that's a misprint. The smart mirror in your bathroom shows the day's weather and also indicates the level of water in your overhead tank. Now, after you take some groceries from your refrigerator for making breakfast, the refrigerator recognizes the shortage of stock in it and places an order for the supply of fresh grocery items. Now, when you step out of your house and lock the door and light, all the light fans, geysers and AC machines get switched off automatically. On your way to office, your car warns you about the traffic congestion ahead and suggests an alternative route. And if you are late for a meeting, it sends a message to your office accordingly. So, in the context of emerging communication technologies, which one of the following term best applies to the above scenario? Answer is Internet of Things, IoT. That's like very, very, very genuine and very obvious. But moving on to the explanation. So, Internet of Things is the network of physical devices, vehicles, home appliances, and other items embedded with electronics, software, sensors, actuators, and connectivity, which enables these things to connect and exchange data, further creating opportunities for more direct integration of the physical world into computer-based systems that results in efficiency improvements, economic benefits, and also reduced human intervention. And reduced human intervention directly implies lesser manipulation. Alright, so that's what I think. And moving on to the next question we have. With reference to solar power production in India, consider the following statements. So India is the third largest in the world in manufacture of silicon. Okay, I see that, which is wrong. Now, solar power tariffs are determined by Solar Energy Corporation of India. That's also wrong, guys. So, none of them are correct, as you can see in the option, where that's where I have seen. So, every solar panel which is made in India is assembled, while all the material comes from China, Europe, some other countries. We do not manufacture the material used for solar panels. Now, India is yet to develop semiconductor clusters, and that's like way long journey, and I think it's more economic to get the material and then, you know, assemble it. And that is why India is producing, you know, India is one of the nations that is producing solar energy at the least cost among all the developed nations. India is a developing country, but among all the developed nations, India is a developing country which is producing solar power at the least cost possible, and that's amazing. So I don't really feel the need to have manufacturing clusters, but it's good to be independent, so yeah, we can do that. Moving on to the second explanation in the solution. CERC determines solar power tariffs and regulates the tariff to generating companies owned or controlled by the central government. Now, SECI has a power trading license, but it does not set solar power tariffs. Alright, moving on to the next question we have. The staple commodities of export by the English East India Company from Bengal in the middle of 18th century war, option D, which is cotton, silk, salpetre and opium. These were the staple commodities. Okay, just look at the term. All these commodities were in export and import, but the staple commodities were cotton, silk, salpetre and opium from Bengal. Then British Indian Territory was developed as a source of food and raw material for Britain, which fueled rapid growth in its manufacturing sector, crucial to the emergence of powerful capitalist economy. And in the 1750s, fine cotton and silk was exported from India to markets in Europe, Asia and Africa. Now, by the second quarter of 19th century, raw materials, which chiefly consisted of raw cotton, opium, indigo, accounted for most Indian exports. So you can see here in the 19th century, the second quarter, what were the materials, and this is about 18th century, in the middle of 18th century, what are the materials. Alright, so moving on to the next question we have. Which of the following is a very, very significant aspect of Champaran Satyagraha? So option is C. Very significant is option C. So joining of peasant unrest to India's national movement was a very significant aspect of Champaran Satyagraha. Now we'll talk about the Satyagraha here. So Champaran Satyagraha 1917 is the year of Satyagraha. It is when Gandhiji returned from South Africa in 1915. He heard about the case in Champaran that the British forced the poor peasants to grow indigo and they had no other choice. So why was the Satyagraha started? Because Britishers were forcing peasants to grow indigo without giving them any choice to refuse to this option. It was not an option at all. more than cultivation of indigo, what was appalling was the sharing system that was prevalent, which was the Thinkhartia system. Indigo, matlab you are forced to go indigo, and plus the system that was prevailing, you know, in the growing of indigo, the cultivation amongst the farmers was Thinkhartia system. So this was a, you know, a deadly system, I would say, because according to Thinkhartia system, farmers were under compulsion to grow indigo on 3 of 20th of their land, 3 of 20th parts of their land, and were allowed to take only 1/3 of indigo produced by themselves. Cool. Now, Rajkumar Shukla was an indigo cultivator of Champaran. The guy, you have to remember his name, Rajkumar Shukla. Do remember his name, Rajkumar Shukla, RKS, or whatever short form you want to, whatever Rajkumar Rao, or however you want to relate it, just remember this name. Was an indigo cultivator of Champaran, Bihar, who met Gandhiji to make him aware of the plight of cultivators in Champaran and persuaded him to come there. It was during this agitation that Gandhiji was addressed by the people as Bapu. Now, this was given by Subhash Chandra Bose, and Mahatma was given by Rabindranath Tagore. So, Champaran Satyagraha, after this Satyagraha, Gandhiji got his two popular names like Bapu and Mahatma. Bapu was by Subhash Chandra Bose, and Mahatma was by Rabindranath Tagore. Very significant aspect of Champaran Satyagraha was joining of peasant unrest to India's national movement that we have already discussed. Moving on to the next question, we have, who among the following were the founders of Hind Mazdoor Sabha established in 1948? The correct option is answer D, Ashok Mehta, T.S. Ramanujam and G.G. Mehta. A.T.G. You can remember it that way, Ashok Mehta, T.S. Ramanujam and G.G. Mehta. So, Hindustan Mazdoor Sabha was founded in Howrah in West Bengal on 29 December 1948 by socialist, forward bloc followers and independent unionist. God. Alright. So, it was founded in Howrah 29 December 1948 by the three kind of, you know, people according to their intellectual capacity or intellectual approach, let's say, not capacity, but the approach, yeah. So, there were socialists, forward bloc followers and independent unionists. I got it right this time. Now, its founder included Basavan Singh Sinha, Ashok Mehta, R.S. Ruikar, Maniben Kera, Shivnath Banerjee, R.A. Khedgikar, T.S. Ramanujam, V.S. Mathun and G.G. Mehta. Note down these names. They're very important. These questions are frequently asked in UPSC examinations or other state or union examinations. So, do pay attention to these and make notes of this video. Why are you sitting like barehanded? Just make notes of this video. With reference to religious practices in India, the Sthanakvasi sect belongs to, the correct answer is Jainism, option B. Now, Sthanakvasi is a sect of Swetambara Jainism founded by merchant named Lavaji, and the year is 1653 AD. So, Lavaji, Sthanakvasi, Swetambara Jainism are the important terms here. Make notes of them. It believes that idol worship is not essential in the path of soul purification and attainment of nirvana or moksha. Moving on to the next question we have. With reference to the cultural history of India, consider the following statements. White marble was used in making Bulan Darwaza and Kanka at Fatehpur Sikri. That's right, and that's the only right statement here. So moving on to the next question before that explanation is here. Alright, I just forgot about it. Okay, so Bulan Darwaza at Fatehpur Sikri was built by the great Mughal emperor in Akbar in 1601, and Akbar built the Bulan Darwaza to commemorate his victory over Gujarat. So when he won Gujarat, he was like, okay, let's make some great thing over here, and he made the Bulan Darwaza. Now it is made of red and buff sandstone and decorated by carving and inlaying of white and black marble. What a perception. Now, Rumi Darwaza was built by 3rd Nawab of Lucknow, Nawab Asafuddaula, and is believed to be identical to an old gate in Istanbul called Babi Humayun. That's what Rumi Darwaza resembles. Now, it is so sometimes referred to as Turkish gate because it resembles this Iranian gate, Babi Humayun in Istanbul. Sorry, Turkian gate, not Iranian. So, it's sometimes referred to as a Turkish gate, the Rumi Darwaza. The materials used for Rumi Darwaza is bricks and then coated with lime, while the Mughals often used red sandstone. So it was not by the Mughals, it was by Nawabs and the third Nawab of Lucknow, Nawab Asafuddaula. So it was not really with the red sandstone but with bricks covered with lime. Now, which one of the following foreign travelers elaborately discussed about diamonds and diamond mines of India? So the correct option is Jean Baptiste Tavernier. I don't know if that's the right pronunciation, but that's the right name for sure. So Jean Baptiste Tavernier. Tavernier. My God. I think I need some water. Yeah. So Jean Baptiste Tavernier was a French traveler and merchant who elaborately discussed about diamonds and diamond mines of India. Now the next question is, with reference to Indian history, who among the following is a future Buddha who is yet to come to save the world? This is my favorite question. I love this question, and I don't know why, but I just love it. The answer is Maitreya. So he is yet to come, and I'm really eagerly waiting for him. So the term Bodhisattva literally means one who has enlightenment as his or her essence, from Bodhi, which is the awakening or enlightenment, and Sattva, which is the essence. Now, it is not simply another term for Buddha, though a Bodhisattva is a being who is destined for enlightenment rather than one who has gained it already. Then we have Maitreya. So Maitreya is going to be successor of Gautam Buddha and is also the future Buddha who is yet to come to save the world. And he holds a water fial in left hand. It is said that he will arrive when oceans will decrease in size, which are actually increasing because of global warming. And that is why he keeps a kumbh or filial in his hand and will rule the Ketumati pure land, that is Varanasi. So product of India again. Not a joke on religion, but yeah, I'm India. That was sensible. So next we have the next question, obviously, which is, which of the following statements does not apply to the system of subsidiary alliance introduced by Lord Wellesley? The right answer is right in front of you. It's option B. So to keep India safe from Napoleon Danger was not the objective of subsidiary alliance by Lord Wellesley. Now let's see as to what was this alliance system then. If not the option B, then what was it? So it was a non-intervention policy used by Lord Wellesley, who was the Governor General from 1798 to 1805, 7 to 8 years, to establish British Empire in India. Now, according to this system, every ruler in India had to accept to pay a subsidy to British for the maintenance of British Army. Cool, subsidy for the maintenance of British Army. And in return, what would the army do? It would protect them from the enemies, which gave British enormous expansion. Now, those native princes or rulers who would enter into subsidiary alliance would not be free to declare war against any other power, because obviously you don't have the control over army, so how can you declare a war? And they could not even enter into negotiations with any power, native or otherwise, without the consent of the English, because English had the control over army, the defense, the security, so you could not really merge with others or have agreements with others or declare war against others. Okay, now that's how the princes and the princely states were bound, and Britishers became powerful. Now, princes who were comparatively strong and powerful would be permitted to retain the armies, because obviously, like, they would attack on you guys, but the armies must be placed under the British general, so that Britishers are always superior. Now next we have the 16th question. It's getting too long for you, I guess, and for me as well. But we will finish at least 50 questions in this video, because, you know, I would keep the rest for next video. Now in the first Lok Sabha, the single largest party in the opposition was the Swatantra Party, okay, which is a wrong option. In the Lok Sabha, leader of opposition was recognized for first time in 1969. Okay, so that's correct, guys. And it was not Swatantra Party in the first option, it was Congress. That's, everybody knows it. Then we have a third option, which is wrong. I'm not going to read it. So we have the explanation here. So 1952 elections, Congress had won most number of seats, more than 80%. CPI was second party with just 16 seats. And Swatantra Party was an Indian liberal conservative political party that came into existence in 1959. Okay. And lasted till 1974. Leader of opposition was recognized for the first time in 1969. That is true. To become leader of opposition, political party needs at least 10% strength of the house. And this is a convention. It's not given anywhere. So before 1969, nobody actually got 10% seats. It was all about Congress, and the rest seats were distributed among many smaller and local or regional parties. Now, which of the following leaf modifications occur in desert areas to inhibit water losses? Okay, and alright, so the options are hardy, hard and waxy leaves, that's true. Tiny leaves, that's also true. Thorns in the roof, that's also true. So all of these basically help water loss, and all the options are correct. The vegetation of hot desert climate is xerophytic type. Remember the name, xerophytic type is desert vegetation. Okay, it has special characteristics to withstand very high rate of evaporation. What are these characteristics? Long roots, thick barks, hard and waxy leaves, thorns, little leaves. Now, as per NSSO 70th Round Situation Assessment Survey of Agricultural Households, consider the following statement. Now, I'll just read the correct statement, which is first and third. So, Rajasthan has the highest percentage share of agricultural households among its rural households, and Kerala, a little over 60% of agricultural households reported to have received maximum income from sources other than agricultural activities. So, NSSO, the 70th Round Situation Assessment Survey of Agricultural Households, has the following findings. Rajasthan highest, Kerala 61% agricultural households, more income from agricultural sources, and the share of OBC households among rural households is about 45%, less than 50%, and you have to remember that. Moving on to the next question we have, how is the NGT different from Central Pollution Control Board? So NGT has been established by an act, whereas the CPCB has been created by executive order of government. That's cool enough. NGT provides environmental justice and helps reduce the burden of litigation in the higher courts, whereas CPCB promotes cleanliness of streams and wellness. Which this one is correct. The first one is cool enough but not correct, and second one is correct. So that's about this particular question. Both are statutory organizations, and Central Pollution Control Board, CPCB, was constituted in September 1974. Under the Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974, and NGT was established under the National Green Tribunals Act of 2010. So NGT is a younger body and CPCB is an older body. The NGT provides environmental justice and helps reduce the burden of litigation in the higher courts. CPCB promotes cleanliness of streams and wells and aims to improve the quality of air in the country. The next question that we have is, Parliament of India can place a particular law in 9th schedule of the Constitution of India. Validity of a law placed in the 9th schedule cannot be examined by any court and no judgment can be made on it. So guys, the first one is absolutely correct, but the second option is rubbishly wrong. I don't know if you could notice or not, but yeah, it's not the right option. It's given in the answer also right below the question, so you can see it. My explanation to this is, Parliament of India can place a particular law in the 9th schedule of the Constitution of India. And validity of a law placed in 9th schedule can be examined by any court and no judgment can be made on it. Now, this is what the Supreme Court has ruled on 11 January 2007, that all laws including those in the 9th schedule would be open to judicial review. So no law is spared, okay, not even the 9th schedule, if it violates basic structure of the Constitution, which was laid down in Keshwanand Bharti case, the basic structure case. You guys have to remember it with preparing for UPSC, guys. Also, I think that was like enough for this video because it's getting too long. I said I'll cover 50, but I'm stopping at 20 because it's getting too long, guys. It won't be easy to revise and sit and listen to everything here. So, 22, I think 20, and yeah, so I'm gonna make 5 lessons for the series of 2018 previous year questions. You can tune in to the next video, and I'll see you there. Until then, keep learning and keep watching. See you.